Let's build a reusable component for running Databricks jobs. Here you can see I have a demo job that I want to start scheduling in Dagster, and I want to make it so it's easy for other people to schedule jobs too. So I'm going to do that by building a component. We're going to follow along the creating a new component guide. So we're going to start by scaffolding a component. On the right here, I have an empty project. You can see if I run tree, we just have an empty source directory. I'm going to run dg scaffold component, and it's going to be called Databricks Job Component. We're actually going to model it similarly to the shell command component that we have in the documentation. So we want to be able to run the job and then attach assets to it. So first, let's go ahead and open up that component that it just created. So in the components directory, we have a Databricks job component. Now let's think through what we actually want to do in this component. If we scroll down in the documentation, you can see this component takes in a script path and a list of asset specs. But for our Databricks job, it's going to be a little bit different. I think we want to take in a job ID. We still want to take in the list of asset specs to attach assets to our Databricks job, but we'll also need some additional configuration. For example, the authentication token to Databricks and the workspace that we want to run this in. If we want to get a little bit more sophisticated, we can also pass in job parameters that will be passed in to this the job that we're running, or a cluster configuration file. Let's start by adding a way to specify the job ID. So we'll go in here and we'll say, this component can take in a job ID parameter that is a string type. We're also gonna copy the asset specs, and we're gonna say it can take in a list of assets, which is a sequence of resolved asset specs. So essentially metadata for the assets that are being produced by this job. So from typing, I'm gonna import sequence. And we're gonna follow this guide to similarly produce a multi-asset definition for this notebook. We're gonna go ahead and skip this part about adding metadata, but we're gonna go down here and take some of this code for building the definition. So you can see in this build defs function, let's copy this build defs function. And you can see what it does is it takes in just the self, this class, and it produces a definitions object. And we also have access to the component context, which we shouldn't need to use here, except for logging purposes. It then produces a multi-asset. It returns a definitions object with our multi-asset. In this case, the multi-asset's name is based on the script path, but we're gonna actually just change that so that the name of our multi-asset is the job ID. And we still want to take the asset specs like we did in the tutorial. You can also see that in this multi-asset, the way it actually runs the code is by calling this execute function. And in that execute function, it runs a subprocess of that shell script. We're going to change this to instead launch the Databricks job. So I'll skip that for now, but we'll come right back to that. We no longer need this resolved script path variable. And let's open up another terminal and just do dg list definitions. Oops, after I activate my Python virtual environment. So we don't have an actual definition of this component yet, but if we do dg list components, we can now see we have this Databricks demo component, and it's a Databricks job component. Let's go ahead and scaffold that component. So I'm gonna go ahead and copy this and do a dg scaffold defs the component key, and then I'm gonna name this one example Databricks job component. Now if I look in under sources and I look under the defs directory, you can see we have this example Databricks jobs component and a defs.yaml. If I go ahead and edit that, you can see we have list of attributes. And in this case, we're going to pass in the job ID of our Databricks notebook. So I'm going to go ahead and copy that and paste that here. But now let's go back to the actual definition of our job component. We need to make it so that this can run the notebook itself. To do that, we're going to take a look at the Databricks SDK. We're going to need a workspace client. We're also going to need a way to run and wait for the job to finish running. So first things first, I'm going to go back down here and I'm going to do a UV add of the Databricks SDK. And then I'm going to come back up here and I'm going to import this workspace client. So from the Databricks SDK, we're going to go ahead and import workspace client. And now we need to get the actual credentials we need to instantiate this workspace client. You can see it takes in an account ID, a username, a password, a client ID, client secret, a token. I think we're going to go the token route this time, and we're going to go ahead and introduce two more attributes for our component. So we're going to say we need a Databricks host, which is a string, and a Databricks token, which is a string. So we're going to say client equals workspace client. The host is this Databricks host, and the token is our Databricks token. All right, great. Now we want to use this client. Before we do that, let's go and add that to our definition itself. But instead of hard coding these secrets, we're going to want to make use of environment variables. So going back over to the Dagster documentation, let's see how we can use environment variables. So in the sidebar, we have using environment variables with components. And if I scroll down here, you can see some examples of how you, within Jinja templating, you can access these environment variables. You can also see you can specify which variables are required in this component. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to go ahead and copy this requirements. And what we want is a Databricks host and a Databricks token. And let's go ahead and copy one of these as an example too. So for our Databricks host, we want to get that from the environment variable Databricks host. And for our Databricks token, we want to get that from the Databricks token. Great. So now that we have our client, let's actually run this Databricks job. So looking through the documentation, I found this run now and wait function. And it looks like you can go client.jobs.run now and wait. And you can provide a lot of different parameters. The simplest approach would be to just provide the job ID. So let's go ahead and try that. So I'm going to say job ID equals the job ID that's coming from our component definition from the YAML file. So I think that's all we need. We have our new custom component, and we've also created an instance of this component that we've configured. So I'm going to go ahead and do first DG list defs. And we actually got an error. So let's look at that. So it looks like I provided in the component definition, I provided an integer as the ID when the ID is expected to be a string. So I'm going to go up here and change that to be an integer. And let me just double check that this run now and wait expects an integer. That's right. Okay. Let's try list defs again. Oh, now it's saying there's a validation error. Missing job ID. So we need Oh, assets, of course. So we need to define the assets for that example component. And I'm actually gonna go back to the documentation to see how we did that for the shell components. Ah, okay, so scrolling into the advanced component customization section, this is where we add a custom scaffolder. I found an example of how you attach the asset specs. So we need to go down here and say assets. And we're gonna say that this Databricks notebook is producing a CSV file. So we're gonna say this is the example CSV report that we're generating. We're gonna give it a description saying Databricks CSV file produced by Databricks job. And let's go ahead and give it some kinds tags as well. So we're gonna say this is a CSV and Databricks. Now what happens when I list the defs? Oh, one more error. It looks like I still said asset specs here when it should be assets. And one more time. It says name is not a string. That's right, so the job ID is an integer. So I'm gonna go ahead and cast that to a string. Nice, so we have our example CSV report asset. I'm gonna go ahead and run dgdev. And then open up localhost 3000. You can see we have our example CSV report. You can see it has our CSV and Databricks kinds tags. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and materialize it. So this should now go ahead and launch that Databricks job using that jobs.runNowAndWait. So I'm gonna give it a second. It looks like it's starting to run. And then we can go back over here. And yeah, we can see we now have a queue job running. So let's summarize what we just did. We created a custom Dagster component for running Databricks jobs. It allows you to use a simple YAML interface where you provide a job ID and you can attach asset specs to it. So you can now represent the assets being produced in Databricks in Dagster through a simple YAML interface. And you can see here an example of that. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. We could make this much more sophisticated in like refactoring this into a workspace class. We can tweak it to have custom cluster configurations, all sorts of things. But at a very bare minimum, we now have a way to run Databricks jobs in Dagster and configure it all through YAML.